Cuba and the Platt Amendment. Apparently a number of people asked that this be done about Cuba. That's what I was told by the front desk. Because of what Mr. Obama was doing last year, opening up relations with Cuba. And I thought, well, maybe we ought to look at it from a position of history here. Cuba and the Platt Amendment, which was our diktat to the Cubans, actually, when we supposedly freed them from Spanish rule, but that was coming on anyway. But I mean, if you fast forward to today, Mr. Obama gets criticized in certain quarters for this, right? Doesn't he still get criticized for this? However, let's understand one thing here. Two things of importance. Mr. Putin, when he made a visit to Cuba a couple years back, Cuba still owed Russia from the old Soviet Union $35 billion. They still owed Moscow $35 billion. Well, guess what they did? Guess what Mr. Putin did? The $35 billion, he scratched out $32 billion of that debt. Scratched out $32 billion. And the other $3 billion, you know what he did with that? Gave it to Cuba and said, throw it into your education system. And on top of that, there was, you know, this fact last year when they were supposed to have a big Organization of America meeting, some of those governments down Central and South America said, hey, if Cuba's not allowed to attend this, don't bother showing up. What do you think Mr. Obama's going to be doing here? There's almost no choice here. You better open up relations with Cuba. So who outlasted who here since the Kennedy administration? It would seem Cuba has, but that remains to be seen. But I mean, this goes back to what Mr. Putin sees with regard to what we were doing in Eastern Europe, pushing NATO into Eastern Europe. So what's the message here? You play in my backyard, I am going to play in your backyard. In fact, he even gave a loan, even before he stopped in Cuba, stopped in Nicaragua, and negotiated military equipment. He was selling them tanks and so on and so forth. And then I think he stopped in Argentina, I believe it was, and helped them arrange financing for nuclear power plants. So, I mean, he was playing in our backyard, so to speak, in Central and South America, characteristically, been America's sphere of influence. Just like Eastern and Central Europe at one point was Russia's sphere of influence. But again, when you go back to see Cuba years ago, it's somewhat of a different story. In fact, it was Thomas Jefferson who once stated, I think it was in 1808, that Cuba would be a wonderful jump-off point for spreading republicanism south. Using that as a jump-off point, a platform for spreading republicanism south. Keep in mind, at this point, you know, you come out of the 17th going into the 19th centuries here, and a republican form of government, most of the major powers are monarchies. This is an affront. God forbid that people be able to determine their own agendas here. That's what you're seeing in some fashion or form. But you know, this is quite radical. Just like Marxism will be radical in the 20th century. You know, upsetting the status quo is what's happening here. Interesting what you see. But it's actually, you know, when you go back to Cuba, it's actually Christopher Columbus that lands here, 1492. And they've been populated to a certain extent by Indians who had made it off Central and South America to Cuba. But of course, what happens when the Europeans show up and bring smallpox and so on and so forth? What do you think happened to a lot of the Indian population? Wiped out, right? Yeah. That's interesting too, when you look at what happened to the Philippines too when the Europeans showed up. Of course, some of that was Christianity against Islam too, because a lot of those people were Muslims. Not as many Muslims there anymore. Part of that is the attrition rate that went on for centuries. Interesting what you find. Hawaii, same thing. You know, when the British explorer, you know, Mr. Cook landed there in 1778, and after that, when we began to move in there, earlier part of the 19th century, the whalers and traders going into the Pacific, there were like 200,000 people that lived in Hawaii. I'm talking the native type, and by the time the 20th century rolled around, there's only 20,000 left. Yeah, wiped out. Wiped out. And so you see the same sort of thing in Cuba. Of course, in Cuba, what develops here is the sugar industry. You know, and sugar was very important, the plantation system. And as these people on the islands who were subdued are being wiped out, what are they bringing over? Blacks from Africa, right? The slave trade later on. Well, what do you think happened to some of those blacks who were commiserating with Europeans? Some of them start dying out too. And, you know, and when, you know, when you talk about the slave trade, it's interesting here because as bad as slavery was here, the environment on the whole was decidedly better than being a black and being dumped in Cuba, Haiti, Brazil. The attrition rate of people, slaves here, is astounding. Absolutely astounding, to the point really that by 1776 or so, almost all the slaves that are here stateside are born here. The slave trade was doing this. Most of the slaves by the American Revolution were domestically born here. Not so in Central and South America. This trade was still going. Why? The attrition rate. I mean, where would you rather be? Picking cotton in South Carolina or shucking sugarcane in some jungle in Cuba? And I think I'd know where I'd rather be. And that was tragic too, when the British were trying to get the slaves to turn against Americans during the American Revolution. Some of the slaves left when the British evacuated, thinking something better was coming down the road. Guess where some of them wound up? South America, now the Caribbean. So their lot really didn't improve. But you see here, you get into the, you know, by the 19th century, these revolutionary ideas beginning even to percolate in Cuba. And there's a foment going on here to throw out the Spanish occupier. Keep in mind, you know, in the 19th century, Spain doesn't have much in the way of an empire left. They're dying. They're one of those European one of the first of the European colonial powers, but they're dying at this point. Absolutely dying. Napoleon didn't help them when he occupied Spain in 1808. And that began a 5-year guerrilla war in Spain. But when he occupied Spain, how were the Spanish supposed to hold those colonial, you know, their colonies in Central and South America? How can they hold them? They can't. And what happened to that gravy train of gold and silver and so on and so forth, the ships going back and forth? What happened to that? Dried up. Well, what do you think happened to the Spanish treasury? That would dry up. So these people in Central and South America can thank Napoleon for this, and to a certain extent. But you know, they still have Cuba, they still have Puerto Rico, and they got the Philippines in the Pacific. Because what happens here later on, the end of the 19th century, what happens to Cuba will happen to the Philippines, and that's no accident. That is no accident. Because America is coming on as a power in the 19th century. This is happening at the same time. But you see between 1868 and 1878, the rise of the Cuban people to throw the Spanish out. And the Spanish will use methods, draconian methods, to keep the Cubans in line. And this gets the United States involved. There was a ship called the Virginius. This occurs in 1873. The Virginius was a Scottish steamer / sidewheeler that had been in service with the Confederacy, 1864-65. Blockade runner. And by 1870, it had been used to run guns and supplies to Cuban insurgents, sometimes coming out of Kingston, running guns to Cuba, and then back again. And the captain of the ship was a Captain Joseph Fry, F-R-Y, ex-Confederate States Navy. Now that's interesting. You got an ex-Confederate ship captain on a what was originally a Scottish sidewheeler slash steamer flying the Stars and Stripes, bringing guns to Cuban insurgents from Kingston, which is a British-occupied territory. Now, you can't make this up. Well, in October of 1873, as the Virginius is closing the Cuban coast, she's spotted by a Spanish corvette, the Tornado. Well, now the chase starts. And the Tornado will chase the Virginius almost into Kingston and overtake the Virginius, force it back to Cuba. Aboard are 300 rifles, thousands of rounds of ammunition, and some explosives. There is also Captain Fry as commander, flying the Stars and Stripes, but there are Americans, Britons, and Cubans on board. They will be brought to Santiago de Cuba. And at Santiago, the military governor there will begin the executions. Fry will be one of those shot. 53 will be shot, or bayoneted, whatever the case may be, until the British warship HMS Niobe shows up. Now, why would the Niobe be there? Because the Virginius was captured in British territorial waters, considering that Kingston's a colony of the British Empire. And the captain of the HMS Niobe stated that if these people aren't released, we're going to start shelling Santiago. Well, the people were released. Of course, 53 are not. They're dead. And back here in this country, you know, keep in mind the massive demobilization that went on in this country after the Civil War. Well, how do you think some Americans felt about having the British pull American chestnuts out of the fire? You think that set well? No. And this is where you begin to get rumblings of, well, we better rebuild the United States Navy. And in the 1880s, that's exactly what's going to happen here. The new steel navy. You will now have, in the early 1880s, on the Navy War College. And so America is beginning to rearm. And as you see here, as America's rearming, it's growing by leaps and bounds, industrially. And again, the idea again comes up, Cuba. Cuba, spreading American influence south into Central and South America. I mean, numerous times, even in the 19th century, the United States Navy, even as small as it was, would make incursions into many places in Central and South America. Cuba was one of them, chasing so-called pirates preying on American shipping. We did this on and off all through the 19th century. Of course, again, we didn't have a large navy. In fact, there was a Captain David Porter who in 1813, during the War of 1812, went to one of the islands known as French Polynesia, who would actually occupy one of those islands and claim it for the United States. Of all the nerve. And Congress didn't back it because there was no way that we could occupy that island and make sure it stayed in the American fold. So the French would eventually finish occupying it as early as 1842. But that doesn't make any difference because we're eventually going to grab Hawaii anyway. So it shows you where America was going even early in the 19th century. But as we grow as a great power, especially industrially here, because again, I mentioned this before, 1850, we had produced $2 billion in industrial goods. By 1900, it's $11.5 billion. Interesting. 144,000 factories in 1865, 335,000 by 1900. And we'll be the world's leading industrial power. But it's not just that. It's this idea, yes, our population grows from, you know, around the Civil War, from 23 million to, by 1890, 76 million. It grew three times. And so the great fear is growing here that, yes, we have a lot of people, but can all this population digest the goods we're producing in more and more and more of these factories? no, maybe we have to have foreign markets. In other words, expand the empire. This will later be the Alfred Thayer Mann, Teddy Roosevelt, Senator Beveridge, people like this who are pushing the colonial slash, the colonial agenda here. And yet there are people like, some of these people, like, I guess Rockefeller was one of them, that was looking, not, whenever you get into a war like this, if you're going to expand overseas like this, colonies, that leads sometimes to war. And some of these people were against this because they thought it would interrupt business. I mean, keep in mind at the same time, you've got somebody like Alfred Thayer Mann, when he writes that book, The Influence of Sea Power Upon History, mentions that a navy guarantees you overseas markets. Does that sound provocative? Yeah. It couched in certain language? Yes. And so you begin to see this idea of forcefully moving Americans overseas. This gets you to Cuba, Puerto Rico, the War of 1898. In fact, if you read this, it's interesting here. The Platt Amendment. This is based off an amendment actually offered by Senator Orville Platt of Connecticut. And the Platt Amendment's interesting. After we take Cuba, it's interesting how, there was an amendment passed by a senator Teller that we were not in Cuba to virtually tell the Cubans what to do. We were there to ensure their freedom. Well, guess what this Platt Amendment reads when it's actually passed in 1903? Interesting what you see here. Item one, this is fascinating, that the government of Cuba shall never enter into any treaty or any other compact with any foreign power or powers which will impair or tend to impair the independence of Cuba. Now, who gave us the right to phrase such language?
Isn't that part of the Monroe Doctrine?
Ah! Europeans stay out, but we'll oversee it. Now, this goes back to what the Japanese are later going to do. Remember this thing called the Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere? How many people remember that? This was the idea of the Japanese Empire. This thing called Haku Ichu. The eight corners of the world will be under one roof. A Japanese roof. This is no different than Lebensraum, the German idea of moving to the east at the expense of the peoples living there. Now, this is no different. It all winds up being the same thing. In other words, what some of these people are believing is the Anglo-Saxon has the right to bring the uncivilized into the civilized world. You know what's interesting here? And I found this here. Anyone here ever heard of a cleric by the name of Josiah Strong? He wrote a book in the 19th century. The book is called Our Country. Simple title, 1885. Now this is a cleric. Not that that really makes any difference. I mean, a power monger is a power monger, however way. He says here in his book, Our Country, civil liberty and pure spiritual Christianity, the greatest of all human contributions. It follows then that the Anglo-Saxon is divinely commissioned to be, in a peculiar sense, his brother's keeper. There's something to put your money in the basket for every Sunday. For the United States, that divine commission was, according to Strong, a mandate to move down upon Mexico, down upon Central and South America, and out upon the islands of the sea, over beyond Africa and beyond. This is a cleric in the 19th century. That's fascinating. That's absolutely fascinating. Interesting here too. Now, again, this Senator H.M. Teller assured the world that the United States had no intention of acquiring Cuba and would leave the government and control of that island and its people. Of course, the United States did not want to assume the $400 million debt that Cuba had too. However, at the same time here, again, you see with the Platt Amendment, part two, that government shall not assume or contract any public debt. This is the Cuban government. The United States is telling Cuba what they should do here. That the government of Cuba shall never enter into any treaty or other compact with any foreign power or powers which will impair or tend to impair the independence of Cuba. Now, who are we to tell these people that? Nor in any manner authorize or permit any foreign power or powers to obtain colonialization or for military or naval purposes or otherwise lodgment in or control of any portion of said island. In other words, we would not want to see British, French, or a resurgence of Spanish military on that island. Of course, it's only 90 miles off the United States. Again, as Keith mentioned here, does this reference the Monroe Doctrine? Of course it does. Of course it does. Again, it's interesting what you see here. Three, that, now this is interesting, that the government of Cuba consents that the United States may exercise the right to intervene for the preservation of Cuban independence. Who gave us the right to do that? Boots on the ground. That's what gave us the right. That's how this works. The maintenance of a government adequate for the protection of life, property, and individual liberty, and for discharging the obligations with respect to Cuba imposed by the Treaty of Paris of the United States. Four, the acts of the United all acts of the United States and Cuba during its military occupancy thereof are ratified and validated, and all lawful rights acquired thereunder shall be maintained and protected. This is in, five is interesting one, that the government of Cuba will execute, as far as necessary extend, the plans already devised or other plans mutually agreed upon for the sanitation of cities of the island. In other words, we're going to help clean Cuba up, get rid of disease, so on and so forth. That's not a bad thing. To the end that the recurrence of epidemic and infectious diseases, now get the wording here, may be prevented, thereby assuring protection to the people and commerce of Cuba, as well as to the commerce of the southern ports of the United States, the people residing therein. What are they telling you here? They want to take over the sugar trade. That's what they're telling you. And if we're going to get that sugar out of Cuba, why should our people go here, pick up a disease and bring it home? That's what they're telling you. It's interesting. It's fascinating. The political lingo here. Interesting. It's absolutely fascinating. And so this is not much different than what the British are going to do in Iraq in 1920, 1921.
This is nothing more than nationalism, period. I mean, this is what the countries were doing then.
Right. This is all part of this. Well, what you're seeing here is the closing stages of European Christian colonialism. However, we're jumping on board here, as are the Japanese. That's what's happening here. In fact, the Japanese would rather have seen, and it turns out that that would be the case. The Germans wanted the Philippines, and they would rather have us occupy the Philippines than the Germans. That's interesting. And yet, when the war is over with, the Japanese are going to grab the First World War. The Japanese are going to grab all those possessions the Germans had. Interesting what you're seeing develop here. It's absolutely fascinating. Another one here is interesting here too. 25 here. Where is it here? Yeah. Indiana Senator Albert Beveridge. He is a friend of Henry Cabot Lodge of that Roosevelt McMahon Lodge clan, and a member in good stand. He delivered an epic speech at Boston on April 21, 1898, just before the war, just before the Spanish-American War, and he says, American factories are making more than the American people can use. American soil is producing more than they can consume. Fate has written our policy for us that the trade of the world shall be ours. We will cover the ocean with our merchant marine. We will build a navy to the measure of our greatness. He concluded that the Philippines are logically our first target. Now keep in mind, we're going to take Cuba, also the Philippines. And why? Because of China. He's prophesizing here that we're eventually going to get China. And that the Philippines is a jump-off point for China. So it's fascinating what you're seeing develop here coming out of this Cuba Platt Amendment. I mean, we're telling the Cubans here, you can't get into debt with other countries. It's all right for them to get into debt with us. We're going to take control of their resources. Again, this is what the British did in Iraq. I mean, in 1930, the British knew their mandate was going to run out in 1932. And so what did they do? They made a deal, a surreptitious deal with Nuriyah Sayed, the lackey that they had in Baghdad in 1930, 2 years before the mandate would run out. The British can station troops in Iraq anytime they want. Well, what do you think Guantanamo Bay is in Cuba? The British can use troops, and you move their troops across Iraq from one side of the Middle East to the other anytime they want. Guess who was going to control the Iraqi intelligence service? London. Guess who had control of the oil? London. Guess who's going to take control of the sugar in Cuba? The United States. Again, this is how big powers seem to operate here. It's fascinating to see. It really is. It's absolutely fascinating. And we're going to go back into Cuba. You know, after we pull our troops out, we're going to go back into Cuba, 1903, 1909, 1913. We go back in there. It's interesting, in 1913, because of an election. And there were people in Cuba who didn't agree with the election, so they rose up. We had to send the troops in there to put that down. We're going to do the same thing in 1917. 1917 is interesting. Woodrow Wilson sends in 2,000 Marines. 2,000 Marines to put down another round of unpleasantness. And you know what the excuse is? Well, those Marines are training there until they're sent to the Western Front in France. What does jungle training have to do with the trenches in Europe? That's almost like the excuse Hitler was ready to use before the invasion of the Soviet Union. He's putting millions of troops into Poland and Hungary as a jump off into the Soviet Union. And he had a ready-made excuse for Stalin, if Stalin asked. And the idea was, well, I'm putting all my troops there so they won't be bombed by the RAF.
Is this an alternate reality, in using today's terms?
Alternate reality.
Alternate facts. Is that what this is? An alternate reality?
Alternate facts. God, what a crowd this is.
No, I'm just saying it sounds like an alternate reality.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, what did George Bush say, one of the rationales for Iraq? We're bringing democracy here?
I believe him.
You know, and so when big powers make these rationales, it's always good to see what's, you know, that's the icing. What's the cake? What's the cake here? That's the question. And what I find fascinating here is, and I wrote some of these figures down here, it's fascinating what you find here. By 1919, Cuba was an American satrap. J.P. Morgan loaned $50 million to Cuba. U.S. investments in 1898 were $30 to $50 million. Of course, as we grab hold of this, by the mid-1920s, $1 to $1.5 billion. Now that's a lot of money in the early 1920s, $1 to $1.5 billion. Interesting here too, by 1923, 80% of Cuban exports were going to the United States. Three quarters of their imports, guess where they came from? The United States. And by this period, mid-1920s, this island of maybe 3 million people is America's sixth largest partner, economic partner. 3 million people. It's becoming a dumping ground for American goods, just like the British were doing to India. Only India is a far bigger scheme. It's fascinating what you saw come out of this. And this is supposed to be a free nation. This is an example of America using its currency as soldiers. We don't need to put a lot of soldiers in there. We take economic control of the place. Again, using the strong dollar. The dollar are soldiers. We don't need to expend blood here, because if we had expended a lot of blood here, how long do you think that's going to last before the American public gets sick of this? What happened in Iraq? What happened in Afghanistan? So with our growing economic power, we're using that economic power as a bludgeon. It's exactly what we're doing. Of course, you know, Mr. Roosevelt will come along with his good neighbor policy, and this is around the same time in the early 30s. A young sergeant will come along in Cuba and straighten out the politics and take control. Fulgencio Batista? Mr. Batista. And he will become an American lackey. I don't have to tell you where the mob's going to go to hide some of their ill-gotten gains. Cuba. And what happens in Cuba? You know, with the mob moving there and with the sugar interests there, what happens to the people? Yeah, many of them are dirt poor. Prostitution, the gaming going on, no real jobs for these people, unless you're working a sugar plantation. And so by the end of the Second World War, this thing called revolutionary nationalism is gaining credence here. Beginning with the First World War, really, or what you call the First World War, this idea of people will be able to determine their own fate. Some people took this literally. People like Ho Chi Minh, Mao Zedong, and later somebody like Fidel Castro, who at one point was a lawyer. You know, I find some of these guerrilla leaders, it's fascinating what they did in another life before they became a guerrilla leader. Castro was a lawyer. George Habash, the well-known terrorist in the Middle East, was a doctor. A doctor. Interesting how they eschew their livelihood to become revolutionary leaders. It's fascinating. And Mr. Castro will be eventually sent to exile. He'll be sent to Mexico. But he'll return 1953-54 with 83 men. And they will run into an ambush. He will be down to a dozen men. And he will have to hide in the mountains. However, catering to the peasant, just like Mao did before him, just like Ho Chi Minh was doing in Vietnam, and with another revolutionary, Che Guevara. Remember him? I remember some of my friends having his picture up on their bedroom walls.
I just want to mention, I was in Cuba a year ago, and Che Guevara's picture was still everywhere.
Oh yeah, he's still
he's the biggest hero.
He still has a camp following. A big one. A big one. In fact, he wrote a book. In fact, I have it here if someone wants to see it later. On guerrilla warfare. Che Guevara, just like Mao Zedong, on guerrilla warfare. Vo Nguyen Giap, people's war, people's army. I mean, this was popular in the 50s and the 60s, guerrilla war. However, Mr. Castro is eventually going to dethrone Batista. So he's going to have a popular following. Keep in mind, like Jacobo Arbenz in Guatemala, he's really not a communist really at this point. He's a leftist, yes, but he's not really a communist. But that's still not going to go well in the United States here. That's not going to go well at all. You know, it's interesting too, you know, when he sits down and discusses, you know, with the Eisenhower administration, Mr. Nixon, he'll sit down with Nixon and discuss what's going to happen afterwards. Do you know Castro stated he was willing to pay back the United States at 4.5% interest every year any damage is done? And what did Nixon say? No. Big reason for the break. Big reason for the break. Because he represents something we don't want to see here. This revolutionary nationalism. You can say whatever you want about Fidel Castro. Was he a dictator? Okay, I'll give you that. Did he put people in prison? Yeah, I'll give you that. Did he like dissenting opinions? Not wild about it. But he did give these people one thing that they hadn't had for a long, long time. Independence. He might be a dictator, but he's our dictator. Interesting how that is. Saddam might be a dictator, but he's our dictator. And he does share some of the wealth here like Saddam did. Saddam was spending the oil money, rebuilding the bridges, fixing the roads, building up the cities, making sure women were educated and taking their place in society. However, there was that revolutionary aspect of Castro too, of that clique, the Castro-Guevara clique, you know, where Castro was looking to consolidate the revolution at home. What was Guevara trying to do? Export it. Because one of the reasons is to cut back on American influence in Central and South America. He even wanted to carry this to Africa. That's interesting. Of course, these are the days too, afterward. Remember Patrice Lumumba in Africa, the revolutionary leader? Yes, yes.
I was going to say South America, that seems to be their trend. I mean, Brazil, Venezuela, they all seem to be in a constant state of revolution.
Of course, we don't help. You know, we don't help. You know, after the Mossadegh, dethroning by the United States and the British, we're going to do the same thing a year later in Guatemala, Mr. Arbenz, where he wanted to nationalize a lot of the territory where the bananas were being produced, you know, in Guatemala. You know, United Fruit doesn't like that. And so we helped dethrone Arbenz. And, you know, so this starts that trend here. And where we, I was at a meeting not all that long ago, and a couple of people were telling me, I find it disgusting how the Russians got involved in our election. If that really happened, I said, get used to it. I said, what do you think we did in Central America and South America and the Middle East for decades? You don't like it when the shoe's on the other foot, do you? Huh? Yeah. And so, you know, so what you see come out of this today, you know, well, Mr. Guevara is going to try to, you know, extend this revolution into South America. Of course, you know what happened to him in Bolivia. But he is still, like you say, he is a cult favorite with many of these people. And then, you know, he's the guy who wanted to expand their revolution into Central South America and even export it to Africa. And what's Castro going to do in the 70s? Angola? Mm-hmm. Interesting. You know, it's like Castro took a look at the clock here and the calendar and said, America lost in Vietnam. Is America beginning to come apart here? So now maybe is the time to spread the agenda. Because keep in mind what the Soviets see at the same time here. You know, America is losing and is going to lose in Vietnam. And the Israelis beat the Egyptians and Syrians again. And what do the Egyptians do? They throw the Soviets out. Well, you're no help. So they threw them out. And who does Sadat go to? The United States. Why? The money. Not hard to figure that one out. So what are the Russians doing here? They are, it's interesting too, they're backing the North Vietnamese, because what do the Vietnamese do, or the North Vietnam, what does Hanoi do after they win the war in Vietnam? They go into Cambodia? Remember Mr. Pol Pot? Yeah. who winds up being a client of China. Centuries of Vietnamese-Chinese disagreement, and Vietnam goes into Cambodia. Why? They're supported by Moscow. You see that going on. But Mr. Castro will go into Angola. And that's going to help lead to that black revolution in South Africa. This revolutionary idea of getting rid of white rule. That's part of this. Interesting what you see develop here. It's almost like Castro had waited. The 60s are too early. Let's consolidate the revolution at home. Maybe later on we'll export it. It's almost like revisiting Trotsky. Lenin, you know, okay, yeah, we won in 1917, 1918, but we need to consolidate the revolution at home. Trotsky, no, let's keep spreading this across through workers through Europe.
But they still had the thumb on the people.
Correct.
You know, and the people never got any. I mean, they were.
Well, they got one thing.
Well, I mean, they're in a constant state of being controlled.
They got, right, they are, but they got one thing: independence. There's no foreign oppressor. Again, he's our dictator, but, you know, he's a dictator, but he's our dictator. Is this the next step toward real freedom? That would be up to the people. But again, who controlled the people? Who does Lenin give way to? Stalin. Did Castro give up power? No. So it's fascinating what you see develop here, coming out of colonialism. But America's take here, America's input here, it's, you know, we helped to fashion this, just like the Philippines. Again, you go back to what happens after 1945, when the Philippines was supposed to be an independent state, almost like what happens here with the Platt Amendment. We're going to control it. We're going to control one of Cuba's probably greatest asset, sugar. And so what are we going to do in the Philippines? That treaty we signed with the Philippines, turning over control to the Filipinos, guess what it said in Article 341? That Americans can also gain control of Filipino resources. So who are the Philippines an independent nation in 1946? No. No. It's like the British after 1945. Who controls the oil in Iran? The British, which is why Mossadegh nationalized the oil. Well, the same sort of thing happens in other, what were once colonial satraps here. So it's interesting what, and Batista, you know, when he takes power, just becomes another American lackey here. He'll stay in power, he'll put down the people when he needs to. And we don't have to look like the bad guys, because it's not American troops doing this. It's indigenous troops doing this. Why? For the sugar interests and another preferred interest in Cuba, backed by the United States. Interesting what you see develop here. It's absolutely fascinating. Now it's going to be interesting to see where Cuba goes, especially now confronted with the Trump administration. It's going to be fascinating to see. It's going to be fascinating to see. But again, looking at it how Thomas Jefferson saw it in 1808, and we have this fledgling republic we're building here, and we want to spread this idea so Cuba could be a jump-off point going south. Is this what Che Guevara saw? Ah, revolutionary nationalism. Cuba's the jump-off point. Let's go south. Was Mr. Guevara looking at the same map Mr. Jefferson was? Interesting here. Because the map really doesn't change. The map really doesn't change. But again, it goes back to what I said near the beginning here. This idea of republican form of government upset the status quo by 1808. And yet, get to the 20th century, is Marxism upsetting the status quo? Yeah, interesting. Jefferson, Guevara. Yes.
So when I was there, I thought they might be something about the Spanish-American War, but they they minimized America's impact on the war. I don't know. It's just almost like we didn't do anything.
Yeah, yeah.
In the history books.
And it's almost like the Vietnamese, they want the American dollar, so, you know, yeah, we want you back.
That's weird.
It's interesting how some people will look at this. I'm talking about the indigenous people. You know, you had a draconian approach to them. You killed a lot of their people, and yet some of these people seem to get over that and want you back. Some do.
Yeah, well, I think the reasoning is we Americans seem to hold on to grudges. They say, it's in the past. It's all done. We're over. Mm. We've gotten over it. You Americans don't seem to get over these.
I don't know if that's true. I think the opposite is true. Compared to, if I was in Greece and they hate so many people. I have a feeling we get over. We trade with all these people. We accept all these people. We had all these wars with the Germans. We had the wars with all these people. So I think we get over it pretty fast.
Well, maybe grudge is the wrong word, but
it depends on who. If your brother died, maybe it would make a difference. You know.
Hmm.
You know, if you got over it, you know, but. I think we get over it pretty amazing because it's only, you know, what have you done for me lately and what is the future? I guess that's the mantra. It's a working.
Yeah. But you know, it's
interesting. What can you do for me now?
Well, it's interesting here too. I mean, when you know, going bouncing off what both of you are saying here, if you look at the American relationship with Russia, I mean, here's a country that during the American Civil War didn't want the North to lose. They did not want the North to lose to the South. And one of the reasons for that is, being one of our biggest boosters, it's interesting, the Tsar treats this country like it's a prison camp. And yet, we're supposed to be a republic, representative government, so on and so forth. You would think, no. Political expediency? They lost the Crimean War to the British, the French, and the Ottomans. Well, if there's going to be another conflict, perhaps this growing United States can be an ally later on down the road. So we don't want you to lose to the South. We don't want you to lose to the South. We, you know, come on, Abe, win this war. Potential ally. That's what they see. And yet you go to 1917 with the Russian Revolution, there were Americans here that actually supported this, even though they weren't communists. They supported this. Why? The Tsar was a monarch. What did we throw out of here? A monarch? Yeah, we did. Gee whiz, another country doing the same sort of thing. This is great. Of course, till, you know, the Bolsheviks take over, then the Red Scare, so on and so forth. And then you get to the 1939-45 conflict. I mean, the two big winners are the United States and the Soviet Union, but then there's the break here. Of course, when the Soviet Union collapses, what are we doing? After the Soviet Union collapses, we're trying to fashion a government in Moscow that will see things to the West. Henceforth, the alcoholic Boris Yeltsin. And of course, what's happened since? Mr. Putin. Ardent nationalist, perhaps, comes out of the KGB / the FSB, the intelligence services. Mm-hmm. So it's in that case, if this is really true about the Russians hacking into the elections, if this is really true, is this one way of getting us back from what we were doing in Russia during the early 90s, early mid 90s? Hey, you know, big power politics. It's fascinating what you say. But where does Cuba fit in all this? Well, again, go back to what I said before about Mr. Putin. You know, Cuba had a $35 billion debt to the old Soviet Union. Well, we'll wipe out $32 billion of that right off the books. And the other $3 billion, well, you can keep that for your education system. That's nice. What a guy. But he's also doing that because we're meddling in Ukraine. Well, okay, tit for tat. Right, right. Every nation does this. Why? Because they're people. So, it's fascinating what you see develop here. It really is. Anybody have any questions or comments?
Well,
yes?
If Putin likes Cuba, then maybe Cuba will stay with trouble like Cuba. So, nothing's going to change. That's what I'm thinking.
although I don't think you're going to see Russian missiles there anymore.
No.
I don't think you'll see that. But at the same time here...
It's not going to back off the stuff because Putin likes it, right?
Right. But then again, you have to see what Cuba did, too. I mean, with our blockade of Cuba, what did Cuba really get into? Well, one thing they got into was medical care. Talked about that before. Doctors, medicine, free medical care. I mean, go back to what they did with Venezuela. Well, why should we pay Venezuela a lot of money for oil? Why don't we, you know, you give us oil, and we'll send doctors there. What a deal. So Venezuela will go for it. Interesting. I remember there was about, what was it, about 4 or 5 years ago, this lady who was a GI was wounded in Iraq, I think, and she was having a lot of medical problems. And she was running up medical, she couldn't get all the help she needed. She would have run up a lot of medical bills. Guess where she went? Cuba.
So
they treated her for nothing.
I just took a tour a year ago, and there was an orthopedic surgeon on our tour, and he went to the clinics twice. Once, and he went to the city clinic, which he said was spotless and well run. You know, he said it was good. And then we were out in the middle of nowhere, and he went to a local clinic, which was not as clean, but it was fine. So his opinion is it's not a lie that the medical care is pretty good in Cuba.
Yeah, yeah.
It's true.
Yeah, and but they did that. Not only to improve the lot of their own people, but as an export product, medicine.
Sure. No, it's one of their big exports.
Yes. In fact, after that, after the earthquake in Haiti, guess who was one of the leading exporters of doctors to that? Cuba.
Sure.
Do they train them within Cuba, or do they go to Russia for medical school?
Some of them did go to Russia. Or the Soviet Union, because this starts before the Soviet Union falls. Yeah, some of them went to the Soviet Union for training. And of course, they come back, they impart that training within Cuba, and then they turn this into a program for foreign policy, which is interesting. Almost like Doctors Without Borders, only government sanctioned, if you want to call it that. Interesting. Africa, yeah.
It's a cash cow, but they told us that.
Yeah.
This is how we get money.
Yeah.
Doctors go and they charge them $5,000 a month. We pay the doctor $100 a month.
Yeah.
It's money that real money that the Cuban government.
And it's a commodity. Many of these countries that are down on their luck need medical care,
sure.
Doctors, medicine. They need this, and so. To a certain extent, are they like, I don't know, if you want to make the jump to Saudi Arabia of medicine to certain countries or certain clients that they have? Yeah, it could be. But yeah, Venezuela. Yeah, we'll send us some oil. We'll send you a few doctors. That's what they did.
Did anything replace the Platt Amendment?
The Platt Amendment was virtually dead by the 1930s.
Okay, that's what I wanted to talk about.
You know, with Mr. Roosevelt's good neighbor policy.
Okay.
Of course, by that time, Fulgencio Batista is running the country, and so the Platt Amendment really doesn't mean much anything anymore. But in the beginning here, yeah, it did mean something. You know, it's like one of those agreements that we make with a country that we virtually take over. Well, this is the way it's going to be. If you don't like it, the troops are coming back. That's virtually what you see here. And we're going to do the same sort of thing to the Philippines. And so, of course, the Philippines, their guerrilla war lasted a lot longer. In fact, that was one of the reasons you have a National Guard, and they got rid of the citizen soldier concept. They needed bodies, because when they fashioned the National Guard Act of 1903, by 1908 they added a rider to that, being able to send National Guardsmen overseas. And so where do you think some of these guardsmen went? To the Philippines. You know, the Filipinos weren't really ready to give up at that too easily at that point. But even after a while, some of them saw the handwriting on the wall. Well, we'll wait. And so, of course, William Howard Taft is interesting. When he was sent there as the U.S. procurator, he understood one thing. Why do peasants fight? The land? Don't we want the land? So he bought up, I think it was 676 miles of land from the Catholic Church and gave it to the peasants. And so one of the reasons for an insurgency begins to do this. He understood that. Interesting. Interesting. And that helped to end the insurgency at that point. But then again, you can't legislate the feelings of a people. It's like taking the Confederate battle flag down on government buildings in the South. Is that going to stop some of these people with their license plate brackets or putting that flag up in their front yard or their front windows? No, it's not. So, interesting. It's fascinating. You sometimes can't legislate people's feelings. Interesting.
Just stay away from Mississippi.
The Independent Republic of Mississippi?
Oh, God. I mean, those people. If you've got one, if you have one drop of colored blood in you, you're black. That's how bad it is.
Well, you know, it's hard with some people to give up old beliefs, traditions, and so on and so forth. It's hard. They are one of the poorer states in the nation.
Yeah.
They are one of the least educated states in the nation. It's been that way for decades.
We're at the bottom.
Well, Louisiana's not that far ahead. Mm-hmm. And so it's tough for some people, if you're in that environment, to change.
Yeah, I just saw a movie, Hidden Figures, and it talks about NASA in the 60s.
Mm.
Yeah, that was a classic example of I mean, you have the cast of characters and the segregation that was going on, and you have these gals that, you know, are engineers, mathematicians, yet people don't think about what's in their head.
Right.
They're just looking at the visual and say, no, I don't think so.
Right.
You know, and they say, well, give me a chance. I mean, you know. And
yeah.
The story goes that they knew what they were doing, and we didn't.
Well, you know, again, if you go back, you know, talking about Cuba, a lot of the people who live in Miami and so on and so forth aren't wild about what's going on now. Opening up relations with Castro, that's an affront to some of them. Yet, what are a lot of the younger Cuban Americans doing? A lot of them supported this. That's interesting. That's so interesting.
You got to wait for a number of generations to become diluted until they say.
Correct. Correct. Yeah, that happens. Sure, it does.
Until they change their thing. Yeah.
Sure. Sure, that happens. But again, some of the Cubans who came here directly, having escaped the island, some of them weren't fans of this. Having lost property to the government. For one thing, again, this idea of property is big with many people. I had this property. Well, I don't have it anymore. Or look at Germans who in East Prussia, it's no longer Germany. That's gone to Poland and so on and so forth. There is no East Prussia anymore. Yet that was German territory.
I was thinking there might have been a parallel, like when there was a lot of Chinese bonds. I know I had my roommate in college. His family lost a fortune in China back in. So I don't know how we resolve that. I think they got paid like 1 cent on a dollar or something like that when they came back with relations with China.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What are they going to do with Cuba if they have these final relations? Are they going to do something like that? Or, you know,
that remains to be seen.
There's some money still there that's sold basically.
Yeah.
Confiscated.
That's right.
Oh, speak about the slave trade that you were talking about. I just saw a blurb in a paper where a lot of the captains threw their slaves overboard so they could collect on the insurance for lost cargo.
Mm-hmm.
So now there's not a movement, but somebody in England saying, hey, the ancestors of these folks that got thrown overboard, I think the British government should reimburse them, pay for damages.
Well, that would bring in the Dutch, too.
Oh, yeah.
Because the first slaves brought here in 619 were brought here by the Dutch, 20 of them. Well, that just starts the cascade that's going to follow.
It was just a small blurb place, and I said, oh my God, you go back 300 years, how are you supposed to trace these people?
Well, how are you going to do, where are the records? Where are the records?
Well, I'm sure that you can find a manifest, but can you identify their names?
Well, that's the point.
Marks or whatever?
That's the point. I mean, keep in mind, later on, as slaves come here, they're going to adopt names like Monroe, Madison, Jefferson, Washington. One of the reasons is because they were presidents, they were easy to remember as they become Americanized. What's fascinating about what happened with the slaves was they adopt Christian religion. Baptist being one.
Sure.
That's fascinating. And so were some of these people who were working for their white overseers becoming acclimated to their new surroundings? Yes. Yeah. In fact, by the American Revolution, I mentioned earlier, most of the slaves that were being employed were born here. And there was less of the attrition rate that you saw in the Caribbean and Central and South America because the conditions were a lot better. I'm talking the environmental conditions, not necessarily the treatment. But even here, after a while, I mean, there were not all the slave owners were Heinrich Himmlers. You've got to at least tend to these people in some manner if you want them to work a long time. Of course, one of the downsides here is the slave owner reserved the right when a young slave, a female slave, had a child to take that child and sell him someplace else. That's horrible. That's horrible. And then, as the Confederacy spreads, going from Virginia, West Virginia, or Virginia, the Carolinas, and then going into places like Mississippi, Louisiana, eventually Texas, don't you have to open up the slave market here? Yeah, you do. And so some of these owners of slaves are selling some of their slaves, breaking up families, so new plantation owners moving west can staff their plantations. So now you're breaking up families. Now, that's a horrible setup. It really is. It's a horrible setup. So you're going to go from some 600 some odd slaves during the time of the American Revolution till by 1860, near the start of the American Civil War, almost 4 million slaves. But many of them will be born here as opposed to what was going on in the Caribbean and Central South America. Interesting. But again, as they're born here, they're acclimating themselves to the American social, political, religious, societal environments. So it's fascinating what you saw here. In fact, when I was giving I was asked by the League of Women Voters to give a talk on the Electoral College on Saturday up in Weston, and I did. And going back to the, in fact, I'm going to do that talk here next month as part of that series I'm doing next month, The Foundations of the American Republic. And when you get to the election of 1876, which leads to the compromise of 1877, Rutherford B. Hayes was losing that election by virtually 20 electoral votes.
Is that Tilden? Hayes and Tilden?
Yeah, Tilden had 100, you needed 185 electoral votes. Tilden, the Democrat, had 184.
Yeah.
And Hayes had 165. And so there were four states in question: Oregon, South Carolina, Georgia, Louisiana. And so what happens here is one or two of the electors in Oregon were considered illegal electors. But now that's not the issue. Go to the three southern states. Each of those southern states, the party said, well, our guy won the election. Well, how do you finish the election? Compromise. The southerners agreed, okay, Republicans, you can have Hayes occupy the White House, but the cost is get federal troops out of the South. And that ended the northern occupation of the South. And then once the troops were gone, some of the old attributes of the Confederacy came back. And what happened to blacks as voters disenfranchised?
Old
heads. Right. Interesting what you saw develop here. And Mr. Hayes will win 185 to 184 electoral votes. Wow. What a way to have an election. Wow. So yeah, does the remnants of slavery exist even? Yeah, it does. Yeah, it does. Or it did. Interesting.
Was there a plan of occupation to last for forever. I mean, if this hadn't happened.
No, but you know what the North did too? Some of the troops they sent to occupy the South were black. They used some of the black regiments to occupy the South. That made them real happy. Because you know who else is going to do that? In fact, when my Nazi Revolution course, you're taking that, Norwalk Community College, when the Germans couldn't pay the reparations in January 1923, the French sent troops into the Ruhr, one of the industrial heartlands of Germany. And the Belgians did too. And guess what the French did? They sent some of their colonial troops there from Africa, they're black, to occupy an area in Germany. That went over real good. And so the French took a chapter out of what the North was doing after 1865. Yeah, because there was this rising right-wing extremism in Germany. God, having black soldiers in Germany? What is this? Jeez, the Stahlhelm went crazy. You know, so yeah, interesting what you see here. Interesting. But that's what the North did. They put some regiments of black troop, black regulars in the South. Boy.
Wound, right?
Wow. No, that's not good at all. Not good at all. Wow. But yeah, that was part of the election of 1876. Interesting. Yes. Oh, no, I thought you had a question. I thought you had a question.
Scratching my head.
Oh, all right. Yeah, there's a lot to scratch your head about here. Anybody else have any questions or input? Then I guess we're done.